want to say good evening to each and every one of you. Welcome you to the service. Just want to welcome you and ask you to join in worship with us here this evening. Take your hymns of the church and turn to song number 276. Song number 276. A wonderful Savior is Jesus. A wonderful Savior
is Jesus, my Lord.
Song number 385. Number 385. Jesus, keep me near the cross. Number 385.
Jesus, keep me.
Good evening. Lord bless you for being here, especially invite the Church of Bethel here tonight. It looks like you're well represented. It's good to have you here. We've been blessed the last few evenings with Brother Calvin ministering to us. Tonight, I'd like to read several verses from, if you want to turn to it, you can, Philippians chapter 2. Before we read, just like to announce that if you weren't able to share or forgot to share with the offering we took last evening for Calvin, Brother Calvin, put your offering in the baskets in the back or in the boxes in the back, the offering boxes. Are there other announcements that we should make before we read? Okay, I'd like for you to pay special attention to these verses I'm reading. It's on these verses that biblical community is built. And that's at least the way I feel about it. Reading verse 1, it says, "Is therefore there be any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels and mercies." The word bowels and mercies, we don't use that term much today, but it would mean tender compassions. "Fulfill ye my joy, that ye be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, But in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. In a culture of individualism, our primary concern is myself and meeting my own needs. But in a culture of true community, it's just the opposite is true. We care about each other. When a person is hurting or when he's suffering needs, we care about him. It's not an option. We don't think, oh, well, this time I'll pass. We do. We care. We come to his aid. When a person is in despair or he's floundering, we're there for them. That's how community should be. And that's what Scripture calls us to. I've been blessed with the emphasis that Calvin has put on loving each other. That's so important. In fact, the word agape, as I understand, was basically used or coined for this specific kind of love that Jesus showed us, that God shows us. And it was a emphasis used for the Christian church, the agape love we have for each other. I'd like to ask Brother Calvin to come up and we'll have prayer and then we'll give the time to him. I was going to ask Johnny to lead the song. What was the song, Ken, that we led last evening before we had preaching? Do you remember which one that was? 828. Would you want to lead that, Johnny? We can just stand here and wait, can't
okay,
we?
Sure.
Shall we bow our heads for prayer? Father in heaven, we come to you again, once again this evening, asking for your presence to be with us. We pray that you would fill our brother with the Holy Spirit. He has a message that you have given him to preach to us. We pray the hearts of all of us as listeners would be open and receptive to the word. We pray against Satan and his demons, in the name of Jesus. He has no place here in this service. We thank you for what we've heard. We ask that our hearts would be doing hearts and not only hearing hearts. Thank you for being present with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good evening. I was surprised to see so many people from my church here tonight. So Thank you all for joining us this evening. We are learning a memory verse. So we've been standing together and saying this. Would you stand with me at 2 Corinthians 4, verse 18? And by the way, before we say that tonight, I'm just going to turn there. I was thinking that I should be every night saying a little bit of something about this verse and why it's important. We just keep memorizing it, and, well, why is it important? And just looking at the verses before that, it talks about, in verse 16, it says, though the outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. So that's, to me, speaking of some of us are getting really old, and the body is just wearing out. I saw a brother, Jonah. I've been watching him walk in and out of the building. He used to not walk that way. The body is getting wearing out. But it says the inward man is renewed. And so we could get our focus on to that the outward man is perishing. We could do that. Or then the next verse, 17, it says, our light affliction. Well, we know Paul didn't go through light affliction. It was heavy. So we could get our focus on that. Then he said, then it's like he's saying, no, we do verse 18. And I just think that's the recipe. That's how we're going to make it from beginning to end if we can live in this verse every day. So let's say the reference and the verse and the reference again at the end all together. 2 Corinthians 4:18. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. 2 Corinthians 4:18. Thank you. You may be seated. Tonight, I drove the old way that I used to drive to church when I lived at Gilbert and Sue's. So in 1990, I moved to Indiana, and we drove down, I guess, the County Line Road and turned and went to the, so we were at Kendall's tonight for supper, and we drove by the old Sandy Ridge Church. Now, I don't know how many of you know this, but I'm actually a hillbilly from Virginia. I didn't grow up around here. Many of you know that. Some of you probably didn't know that. And my first church, by the way, in Indiana was Sandy Ridge. That was my first church, the old church. And I sat in Ron Yutzi's Wednesday night youth class. And a year or two ago, he pulled out the list of all the students that were in that class, 31 names. And he told me that out of the 31, that only 13 of them, as far as he knew, were still Anabaptists. And it seems like we are having a hard time passing on our worldview to our children. I would say this is our greatest challenge. I told you that if I'd make a series out of these messages, it was the first one was the greatest mission, then the greatest means, then the greatest. Monday night we talked about prayer. What was that? Anyone remember? The greatest weapon. And then last night was we talked about purity, which is the greatest. Maybe you don't. I think I called it the greatest battle last night. I think that's what I said. Anyway, so I'm thinking of this one. If we would make this a series, this would be the greatest challenge. How can you, here are our children. When they're little, it's so easy, it seems like. And yet, when they're 16 and 17, and frankly, many of them have walked out of our churches. Sadly, in our own church at Bethel, this is also true. And it seems like in our church we have done especially poorly at keeping our boys in the church. Some have moved on to more progressive churches, and some are not going to any church at all. And it makes me wonder, is there something wrong with the way that we are teaching? Or is there something wrong with the worldview that we have? Does our worldview the mindset, the beliefs, the values, the practices, and the lifestyle of the moderate conservative Anabaptist. Somebody labeled Midwest Fellowship moderate conservative. That's who we are. Does that worldview deserve to continue to exist? Is our worldview valid, and is it credible enough that it should be passed on and embraced by the next generation? Well, I believe the answer to those questions is yes. If I didn't believe that, I wouldn't be here tonight. The worldview of the conservative Anabaptist should continue to exist. It is biblical, and it is making a significant and valuable contribution to the kingdom of God, and it is worth reproducing and being reproduced in our families and churches. So what I will be advocating for in this message this evening is that we can make our best contribution in the world as a Christian, as a non-acculturated, non-assimilated believer. These are the Christians who are best suited to build the kingdom of heaven on earth. They are in the world, but not of the world. And they instead have been captivated by the values of heaven. Acculturated Christians, on the other hand, seem to admire and take up the beliefs and values of the surrounding culture. And assimilated, then, is to become part of that culture. To assimilate into and to blend in with until they are indistinguishable from most non-believers. So, to help our children embrace this non-acculturated position is a huge task, and it must be done in the face of tremendous cultural pressures. But it can be done if we can captivate their worldview. Worldview is just, maybe you're not familiar with that term. It's like a pair of glasses. If I had red glasses on tonight, I would look out and everything that I would see would be red. And you're wearing green glasses, you look out and it looks a different way to you because of the preconceived ideas, I guess you could say, of how you're looking at the world. So our underlying beliefs and our values, those form our worldview, and then out of that comes my practice and my lifestyle. So if we can shape and cultivate and captivate the worldview of our children, then they can face these pressures out there in the culture and still maintain that same worldview. That's what I'm going to be advocating for tonight. Just ask a Jehovah's Witness, for example, to change their worldview, and you will find that it is nearly impossible, right? You know they're wrong. You're sure they're wrong. But it is so entrenched that it seems like they would never change. What if we could entrench the right worldview into the hearts of our children? Whoever or whatever, let me say it this way. Whoever or whatever has the worldview has the person. And so I believe that it is the countercultural pressure of the kingdom that will withstand the pressure of the culture. So here's your title for this evening, if you like titles. I called the message tonight, Cultural Pressures and the Countercultural Kingdom. And turn with me to Genesis chapter 13 for a text. Cultural Pressures and the Countercultural Kingdom. Genesis chapter 13. Now what I want to draw from tonight is to look at the story of Lot. And Lot, remember I used those big words. I used the words acculturated and assimilated, right? Lot acculturated and Lot assimilated, okay? He blended in with a culture, and we're going to see whether or not that was a wise move. We're going to see this journey of assimilation and the disaster, I guess you could say, that came out of that. All right, so, but I, what I want to think about, though, is to compare what happened to Lot with, well, here's a little bit of backstory. So if we would go back to Genesis 12, this is where, I missed my text here. Let me go back. In Genesis 12, you don't have to turn there, but Abraham, God had promised Abraham the promised land, and he sends him out in chapter 12, and it says in verse 4 that Lot went with Abraham. Lot went with him, okay? So you just think of that as like a parent is like Abraham, Lot is like your child, and you're headed for the promised land. You want to take your children with you, don't you? Now, by the way, I have a number of evangelical friends that I work with, and some men that I think very highly of and appreciate their testimony and their faith. But they say that we Anabaptists, we're really concerned about passing our worldview onto our children. And in their circles, that it is not so much of a worry or a concern like we have. I am concerned about that. What about you? Okay, so Abraham starts out with Lot, and he takes him with him. Now let's go to Genesis 13 and then begin reading in verse 5. And Lot also, which went with Abram, had flocks and herds and tents. And the land was not able to bear them that they might dwell together, for their substance was great, so that they could not dwell together. And there was a strife between the herdsmen of Abram's cattle and the herdsmen of Lot's cattle. And the Canaanite and the Perizzite dwelled then in the land. And Abram said unto Lot, let there be no strife, I pray thee, between me and thee, and between my herdsmen and thy herdsmen, for we be brethren. Is not the whole land before thee? Separate thyself, I pray thee, from me. If thou wilt take the left hand, then I will go to the right. Or if thou depart to the right hand, then I will go to the left. And Lot lifted up his eyes. And he beheld all the amazing things in the culture. He beheld all the plain of Jordan. That it was well watered everywhere before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, even as the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt, as thou comest unto Zoar. Then Lot chose him all the plain of Jordan. And Lot journeyed east, and they separated themselves, the one from the other. Abram dwelled in the land of Canaan, and Lot dwelled in the cities of the plain, and pitched his tent, or you could say his heart, towards Sodom. But the men of Sodom were wicked and sinners before the Lord exceedingly. If we look back at verse 9, let's just quickly go through this journey of Lot. If we look back at verse 9, Abraham gives him the choice to go to the right hand or to the left. And I believe this was a directional decision that Lot made at this point that affected the rest of his life. You know, once you start out on a path in a certain way, it's not too many people that turn around and go back and go and choose a different way. So the path that you take in the beginning is more likely that's the way you're going to go. He beheld all the plain of Jordan, it says in verse 10. Now, the Bible doesn't say this, but I tend to think of it that Lot had an unholy motivation underneath. How many people do you know? They're making a decision about God and church. And this is what they say, and yet, what is the motivation underneath? Okay. What was Lot's motivation? I believe that he probably had a love for wealth, a love for ease. He should have probably said, not probably, he should have said, Abraham, you're older, you... No, you go first. You pick first, and I'll take whatever's left over. That's what he should have said. But instead, when he was given the choice, he took what was the wealth, the ease, whatever it was that he thought he saw in it. And it says he pitched his tent toward Sodom. I think this was the first step of acculturation. He had a, what would be the right word to say? He had a sympathy for the life that was in Sodom. And so he pitched his tent toward that. Now, after this, if we look at chapter 14, there's this war between four kings against five. And in verse 12 of chapter 14, in the midst of this fight was Lot. He was caught in the middle. And in verse 12 it says, "And they took Lot, Abram's brother's son, who dwelt in Sodom." So before that, he had pitched his heart, his tent, towards Sodom. And now, well, you know, I think of this as like kind of rationalizing. Like, it's not the real reason, but he made up a reason, and he ends up, somehow he ended up moving into, now, by the way, I am not against living in the city, okay? Just so you know, some of you like to live in the country, and I just think there's a place to build the kingdom of God in the city. That's not my problem with what Lot did when he moved in the city of Sodom. I think he had other motivations than it was that he was trying to win the souls of Sodom. All right, so he rationalized, apparently somewhere between chapter 13 and chapter 14, he rationalizes, and he ends up living in the city. Now turn over to chapter 18. Chapter 18. God comes. God said, I'm not sure which verse it is where it talks about, he talked about coming down, and he's going to see whether what he's been hearing about the city is really true. And so he comes down and he says, you know, "Shall I hide this from Abraham, what I'm going to do?" And Abraham was the friend of God, and so God was going to tell him what he was going to do to the city. Verse 17, "And the Lord said, Shall I hide from Abraham that thing which I do?" Verse 20, "And the Lord said, Because the cry of Sodom and Gomorrah is great, and because their sin is very grievous, I will go down now and will see, and see whether they have done altogether according to the cry of it which has come unto me, and if not, I will know. And the men turned their faces from thence and went toward Sodom, but Abraham stood yet before the Lord." And Abraham's thinking about his nephew. Oh no, there's Lot. And so he begins to bargain with God. Verse 24, "Peradventure there be 50 righteous within the city. Wilt thou also destroy and not spare the place for the 50 righteous that are therein? Be it far from thee to do after this manner, to slay the righteous with the wicked, that the righteous should be as the wicked, that be far from thee, shall not the judge of all the earth do right?" And the Lord said, "If I find in Sodom 50 righteous within the city, then I will spare all the place for their sake." Abraham was probably thinking, you know, didn't Lot, surely if he, you know, Lot was a Christian, he went into the city, surely he made some converts, maybe, hopefully at least 50. And of course, then he asked for 45 in verse 28, and he bargains all the way down to 10. And God said he would spare the city if there would at least be 10. Now, in chapter 19, verse 1, it says, "There came two angels of Sodom and Eve, and Lot sat in the gate of Sodom." Now, I've heard that the gate of the city is usually considered in those days, the place of political influence. So, as many Christians are trying to do today, leveraging in the polls and through politics, it seems like this, and they think that, you know, they need to have some influence and some say, and so, and this is what Lot apparently did. This is another step of assimilation. Now, he's right in there with all the rest of them. He's sitting at the gate of the city. But what was the outcome? Which way was the influence flowing? Verse 14, his own family, Lot went out and spake unto his sons-in-law. So after God had told him, "Look, you need to get out, I'm going to destroy the city," and Lot was convinced, and he went and tried to convince his family. Verse 14, Lot went out and spake unto his sons-in-law, which married his daughters, and said, "Up, get you out of this place, for the Lord will destroy this city." But he seemed as one that mocked unto his sons-in-law. Apparently, Lot did not pass on his worldview to his children. And in verse 16, it says, and while he lingered, like the angels, I believe, they actually picked him up and set him on the outside of the city. He himself, even though he knew what God had said, he himself just lingered to the last minute. 2 Peter 2 says that that righteous man dwelling among them vexed his righteous soul from day to day. So he lingered. He lost his family didn't listen to him, or his sons-in-law didn't listen to him. He himself lingered. And in verse 26, we see what happened to his own wife. But his wife looked back from behind him, and she became a pillar of salt. Jesus said that no man, having put his hand to the plow and looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God. What conclusions could we draw from this story? Lot acculturated, and then he assimilated, and in the end, he became totally irrelevant. Totally irrelevant. In his effort to be relevant to the culture, he became totally irrelevant to the kingdom of God. And I would say, like, I want to reach the culture. I do. I care about that. But my greatest fear is not being irrelevant to the culture. My greatest fear is being irrelevant to the kingdom. As we think about, it's really quiet in here. As we think about this challenge, it is terribly hard, I believe. In a community like this, in our large Mennonite communities, Holmes County, Lancaster County, Elkhart County, and it really doesn't matter where you are, but it is very challenging to pass our worldview on to our families. And if you're sitting here tonight thinking, man, what a failure, like my story isn't all written yet. I don't know what my story is going to be. I still feel the same way. I hope I will still say the same thing regardless of what my children end up deciding. But, and in the end, each person does need to decide for themselves. But there are pressures in the culture around us that are impacting the worldviews that are forming in the hearts of our children. And I believe are impacting our churches, okay? Like these things are having an effect. And I'm wondering if these, I'm going to give you a few things here that I think have impacted and perhaps are part of the reason, like none of us know fully the reason, but part of the reason why we have had, you know, those 31 young people. Only 13 still in our circles. All right. So, I'll give you my list. I have just been doing some mentoring with some young men that I meet with from time to time. One of the things that we talk about, that I ask them about, is how are you doing with the 5 M's? And so I'm going to tell you what the 5 M's are that I think, these 5 M's are things that are influencing our worldview and our thoughts and our children. The 5 M's are media, morality, movies, money, and music. Those are the 5 M's. Then I have one other, and I want to plug in at the end, that I think is also a pressure. These are cultural pressures, or you could call it influences, that are pounding away, trying to weasel into your home and help you form the worldview of your children. All right, so the first one is media. What the exposure that we have to media in our homes, what potential is in it to help our children form a wrong worldview, or let's say an acculturated or an assimilated worldview. When we, you know, 50 years ago, when we said, well, the Mennonites said, we're just not going to, you know, here came the radio, and some of the Mennonites said, we're not going to have that. It's not very good. Some said yes, some said no. Then the television came along. And most of our people said no. Okay, there might be a little bit of good on there, but most of it is probably garbage. So, no. I want to ask you, what do you think would have happened if we would have done with the television 70 years ago what we're doing now with the internet? What we're doing now with the internet is we're saying, we're not going to say abstinence, we're just going to say, let's just do it with moderation with some accountability. Let's do that. Over 70 years, I'm just asking you, if we would have did that with television 70 years ago and said, well, let's just do it, you know, in moderation with accountability, I wonder if half of you wouldn't be sitting here tonight. I don't know. But that is more what we're doing when it comes to media. We're not taking the abstinence approach. We're taking the moderation with accountability approach. And one other difference that I notice is when we did it about the TV, this is way before my time even, but we did that as a group decision, right? And more with media, it's more, well, I mean, we kind of have some general guidelines for the group, but it's kind of each individual is making their own decision. I feel like that probably one of the biggest influences of media, now, of course, there's garbage and there's terrible things on the internet. Of course, we know that. We talked about some of that last night. But I feel like probably the most subtle influence that's coming out of it is we're feeding on the shallow end of the pool too much. And before, we just didn't have that possibility so readily, right? And now I just sit down and I'm tired and I go to the shallow end of the pool, and we're kind of taking in that we're becoming quite aware of some of the things that are going on in the culture. We're becoming familiar with its heroes, its movie stars, its singers, its sports heroes, its politicians. Media is helping us to get more caught up in the emotional issues of the culture. For example, COVID and what you think about that. Or the election and what you think about if somebody stole the election or not. I have been so disappointed at some of our people. And when I say our people, I'm not talking necessarily about Bethel. I'm talking about the conservative Anabaptist people. What I heard of how much our people were caught up in this jumping on the Trump bandwagon. It's the wrong kingdom. Pray for Donald Trump and pray for Joe Biden. It's the wrong kingdom. And I think the fact that we have this media available is we're getting drawn in to these emotional issues. We're familiar with the heroes, we're getting drawn into the emotional issues, and we're getting distracted, and we're setting our affection or our attention on things on the earth, which Colossians 3:22 says we are not to do. Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. The cultural worldview is not always sinful, but it does focus on the shallow and the temporal and the irrelevant. Media shapes values, and values shape worldview. All right, that's the first M. The second M is morality. We talked about that last night. I told you that I believe the culture has made a god out of pleasure. Here's an example, a friend of mine that was, I'm not sure if he was ever married. He was in a couple different relationships, had children with a couple different ladies. And then he was dating a third lady, and he was wanting to get married, and I said something to him about it, you know, questioned him about it, and he said, well, Calvin, don't you want me to be happy, don't you? And I just said, well, God cares about your holiness more than your happiness. And, you know, just that was sort of his God, pleasure, especially sexual pleasure. So morality is a big one. And we talked about this last night, but it is impacting our churches where we're having, it is becoming more and more, maybe it was just hidden back in the old days, but it's becoming more common to have spiritual casualties, getting caught up in sexual immorality. This is a pressure from the culture that has made its way into our churches. Media, morality, movies is another one. I believe there was a time in my life where I watched probably hundreds and hundreds of movies. So I know the power that is in it. I know the power of sitting around the living room. Well, shall we play Dutch Blitz or shall we just watch a movie? Ask your children which one they want to do, right? There's a tremendous power. I don't know what it is, but it is just so intoxicating. There's just nothing like a good movie. Now, I'm not saying every movie is bad. But I believe that movies breed admiration for the world's heroes and the world's values. And many times, at least in my life, I don't know how it is in your life, but many times, and I would say most of the time, movies stifle spiritual appetite. And frankly, none of the movies, now this is maybe sounds a little too strong, none of the movies we're watching are how we actually live. Is that right? Very few to none. Recently, I keep getting these emails from Revelation Media. I don't know if any of you know what that is. But so Revelation Media keeps sending me these emails, and every once in a while they'll say, here's a link to watch. Like, they had some good movies that you could watch. You just stream the movie. Like, one of them was the story of Sabina, who was the wife of Richard Wurmbrand that founded Voice of the Martyrs. How many know who that is? Anybody know who I'm talking about? Okay. So I think that's probably a good movie. But anyway, recently they sent a link and they said, here's this new movie and you can watch it free tonight. And it was, I forget the name of it. Some of you probably heard of it. It's a new movie. It's something about a policeman who, he came upon the scene of an accident. Somebody was killed and this guy and his personal struggles. And did he become a Christian? It was a Christian movie. And it looked rather intoxicating. And I thought if I would have asked these girls right here, my daughters, if they would want to watch it, they would have probably said yes. And I kind of wanted to watch it myself. But then I thought, but is that going to facilitate them taking up my worldview, which says, I don't want you to be a policeman. I don't want you to be enforcing. That's what the other kingdom enforces and coerces. And in the kingdom of God, we voluntarily do things or not do things. Right? And so they never even found out, but I just deleted the email. Do you guys watch a lot of movies? There was a close colleague of a highly respected Anabaptist writer who told me confidentially that he believed that this writer who had lost a number of his children to the world had that this had happened partially through the influence of movies. All right, so we have media, morality, movies. Are these things influencing us? Are they impacting the worldview of our children? Or of us as parents? That's three. The fourth one is money. Wow. The fourth one is money. In the Bible, there's something interesting about money where it speaks of the potential that money has to lay up treasure in heaven. You can take this this amoral substance, and you can use it to store up, like was it the rich young ruler when Jesus told him to sell all that he had, give to the poor, and then you will what? Anybody know what it says? You will have treasure in heaven. All right, so you can give away money and then you can have treasure in heaven. Great potential in money. But also, Scripture talks about the potential in money to damn a soul to hell. Jesus talked much and warned much about riches and that we can't serve God and mammon. I believe that money's great danger lies in its power to shift our mission from the eternal to the temporal. And sometimes, as conservative Anabaptists, we may dress very different, but some of our financial goals are just like the rest of the culture. But as long as you dress a certain way, it's going to be okay. We may not be good at missions. Maybe we're not so good at missions. Maybe we're not so good at our theology, but we are good at making money. And so if we could harness the power of money, and if we could get this disease called money giveaway-itis, and we could live in simplicity and contentment and generosity and not luxury. Now, probably all of you, if I would ask you, are you living luxuriously? You'd say, no, not me. No, we're not doing that. Has money, I think, has had a way of impacting our worldview. All right. Those are the five M's: media, morality, movies, money. Oh, I have one more M for you. But before I get to that, I want to say something about, I'm going to try to keep this short, about Reformed theology. I believe that Reformed theology, this is supposed to be revival meetings, but I'm just telling you this because I think that Reformed theology has had a large impact on what we're thinking, what we're listening, and what we've come to believe about Scripture. I'll try to explain a little bit. So when I say Reformed, I'm talking about the Reformation, right? 1500s, Martin Luther started the Reformation. He nailed the 95 theses onto the door of the Catholic Church. He was against the Catholic Church because they, all the abuses and the, you know, paying indulgence, basically buying their salvation or whatever it was. And he said, no, salvation is by faith alone. How many of you have heard that? Faith alone, in Christ alone, faith alone, grace alone, in Christ alone, something like that. Have you heard that? Has anybody heard that? Okay, a few of you have heard that. All right. Luther said we are saved by faith alone. It's not so that he saw that the Catholics were over here in one ditch, and he said, no, it's not that way. It's actually by faith alone. It is not connected to the works, to the good works that you do. It is by faith alone. And so he drove over into the other ditch. You know what? We have been influenced by that ever since. I'm going to try to show that to you in just a minute. However, the only place in the New Testament where the phrase faith alone is written is in a place where it actually says the opposite of what Martin Luther was saying. In the NIV, it words it like this, James 2:24. You see that a man is justified by what he does and not by faith alone. What Reformed theology has done is it has unhinged works from faith. And works, though they are important, this is the belief that it has no effect on my final salvation. Works, though they are important, has no effect on my final salvation. Because it says in Ephesians 2 verse 8, we are saved by grace through faith, not of works. That's the proof text that they give. And so anytime anyone says something about works, and in the way they're speaking of it, they connect works to salvation somehow, people get really nervous. Hey, that's work. Wait a minute. That's work salvation. And you're probably going to end up in hell because you connected works to salvation somehow. That's kind of the mindset. I think where Martin Luther went wrong, and I still disagree with what you're going to hear from John Piper and John MacArthur and Chuck Swindoll and all these guys, Paul Washer, some of these guys, some of these very polished speakers, very gifted men, but that viewpoint misunderstands the difference between initial salvation and final salvation. Remember, I've said this a couple times this week. Initial salvation is when we come to Christ for the first time. Our works are not connected to that. We could be the most rotten sinner. If we in faith cry out to Jesus, we are saved apart from works. However, what about final salvation, which is when you close your eyes for the last time? After you had initial salvation, does that mean that you can go out and live like the devil and do any works that you want to do, and you're still going to be saved? Will those works affect this salvation, or will they not? And I think that's the confusion that this camp is in, and we are influenced by it, because whenever somebody talks about works and connecting it to salvation, we begin to get really nervous, and we don't believe in works salvation. Well, did you know that Jesus connected works to final salvation? Do you know that he did that? This is what he said to the rich young ruler. The rich young ruler came to Jesus and he said, "Good master, what shall I do that I may have eternal life?" Jesus did not say, "Now wait a minute, young man, you don't understand. It's not in what you do. You just have to believe and you just have to have faith." He didn't say that. He answered the man's question, and he told him what he had to do. I heard David Brousseau say this, something like this, that for 1,500 years, there was no controversy in the church between faith and works. After the Reformation, there was a controversy, and it is still there to this day. And so if you are scared to connect your works or how you live to your final salvation, that is going to have an impact on your final salvation, if you're scared to connect those two together, then you've probably been influenced by Martin Luther, by Reformed theology. All right. Wow. I need to put it in high gear to finish. The last M. What I'm talking about right now is just things that are influencing us, and that as we take some of these things in, they are having an impact upon the worldview of our children. It's pounding away at it, and it's helping to form it in a certain direction. I believe that one of the reasons some of our children assimilate is because we've gotten mixed up on our theology. See, in a way, I would say, I don't care what theology you have. I am not a theologian. I am not. But I just know this, that what you believe, your theology is just simply what you believe. What you believe ends up coming out in your lifestyle, okay? Theology affects lifestyle. And so if you look at a lifestyle, if you look at a Christian's lifestyle and say, "No, that's not what I want for my family," then you need to check out what they believe. Then you should check out the theology that is underlying that lifestyle. All right. I just want to say a little bit about music. Christian music, I'm talking about Christian music now. Music is full of theology. I used to not like CCM because of the beat. When I was not a Christian, I listened to a lot of rock music, that kind of a beat, and I knew it wasn't healthy for me. And then CCM comes along, it has the same beat, and I thought, well, that's not good. We shouldn't be listening to that. And I still think that. But more, what I've come to see now is this Reformed theology that I'm talking about is woven into those lyrics. There is a lot of theology in the music that you're listening to on the radio. And because of the catchy rhythm, it's impacting our belief system. The rhythm is so enticing, it's the sugar that makes the medicine go down. Christian books, radio, internet, podcasts, movies, and music are saturated with Reformed theology, and it is little wonder that some believe they can leave your church for an assimilated church and still be a Christian. Now, here's a quick disclaimer. I believe that we can learn from our evangelical friends. Yes, there are some shining stars in their camp. Yes, there are some duds in our camp. But that well is not the well that I'm going to be drinking out of when I'm trying to look for resources to help reinforce the worldview that I want to pass on to my children. All right. Let's look at the antidotes now. Let's look on the positive side. What could we do? What are some of the antidotes to some of these pressures that we're talking about, and how could they help reinforce the worldview we want to produce in our children? I talked about some of this already in previous messages, so I'm just going to try to highlight a few things. Number one, an antidote is the home environment and the family relationships we have. If we want to chart a non-assimilated course, if that's the course you want for your family, then the atmosphere in your home and the kind of relationships is terribly, terribly important. All right, we talked about that a little bit before. The second one, develop appetites in your children. Overcome the draw of the music by learning to sing, by singing together as a family. Overcome some of those movie appetites by reading. And overcome some of the media appetites by watching. So, you know, we've got, the Anabaptists have a lot of resources out there right now that will reinforce your worldview. Use it. For example, Anabaptist Perspectives is one. Sound Faith is one. Church Planting Forum is one. I've listened to many, many messages, and some of these. Plain People in the News. How many of you have heard of Plain People in the News? Anybody here? Just a few. You guys should sign up for this. It costs very little, and you'll get a lot of information that has to do with just your Anabaptist worldview. Just information, but also, for example, when the war in the Ukraine was going on. So what did you get? What did you hear about the war in Ukraine when you looked at Fox News or CNN News? Like you heard, you know, the Russians they're bad, they're killing all these people, and Ukraine was kind of the heroes, and we were feeling kind of sympathetic for Ukraine. Russia was bad. But if you got PPIN, which is Plain People in the News, you're going to get an article that says, you know what? Did you know that over in the Ukraine, there's actually some non-resistant Christians over there, and here's what they're doing in response to what's going on in the war. And I just think that here's a resource that will help us to, okay, here's what's going on out there in the culture, and this is how we should think about it. All right. Here's a big one. I got two more things, and then I'm going to close the meeting. An antidote. I think that we need to see our separation. So what makes us different? This, by the way, this sermon is not to say we're got it all together and we're the only Christians on the face of the earth, okay? Just so I'm clear, I am not saying that tonight. What I'm saying is I don't need to figure out who else is a Christian or is not, but I do want to pass my worldview on to my children. That is what I'm saying. Is that fair? Is it okay for me to say that? So, what is the difference between our brand, if you want to call it that, an Anabaptist worldview and, let's say, the Protestant worldview, I would say one big difference is what we think about separation. What does it mean? The Bible talks about that you're not to love the world and all that. And we hear this in our circles, that we should be separated from the world. So our view on separation is one of the big differences between us and the rest of Protestant evangelical Christianity. Is that right? That's a big difference. Probably the biggest. I wonder if we're a little bit, if part of our problem is we're a little bit embarrassed about that. Like, this is the yucky part that we have to kind of carry this mantle, and we're a little bit ashamed of it. I think we should see separation as valuable. I want you to turn real quickly to 1 Peter chapter 1. Would you turn there real quickly, please? I think we should see separation as valuable. The right view that we should have is that we are strangers and pilgrims. And I love what it says in 1 Peter 1, verse 1. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the strangers. And over in chapter 2, verse 11, the very same word, dearly beloved, I beseech you as strangers and pilgrims. What is he talking about? He's talking about an identity. Is that how you identify yourself? Is that how you think of yourself? I mean, I know you can say that. But is that really deeply seated in your worldview? I am just a stranger here. I love the way that chapter 1, verse 1 says it in the NIV. It says, it begins like this, to God's elect, strangers in the world. We should think of it as we are the ones that are on the lifeboat. The stranger and the pilgrim is the one that is on the lifeboat as it's sitting there on the deck of the Titanic. The people are walking by, they're partying, they're eating and drinking, they're dancing, they're playing their games, and there you are sitting over in the lifeboat, and there's just a few crackers, and you know, it's pretty Spartan. You're in the lifeboat. But you know what? The Titanic is going down. You are. Do you have this identity? Like, I feel like part of our problem is with assimilation with some of our people is we've forgotten this identity. We have lost our identity. We're too much contented and connected to this temporal world that we're living in. We should embrace separation. We should not be embarrassed about it. We should not be ashamed of it. Separation is not bound by fashion, trends, heroes, bank accounts. It has contentment and passion with compassion, and it frees us to invest in the kingdom of God without restraint. Separation is not putting handcuffs on us, but rather it is setting us free from Saul's armor to help us to fight. Part of the reason for our assimilation among some of our people is that I believe we have lost our identity. And finally, the last thing that I have here as the antidote, here's the great anti-pressure. I told you the title was, let's see, what was my title? Let me look at it again. Cultural Pressures in the Countercultural Kingdom. The final one is, it's got to be the kingdom of God. Jesus said, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Jesus was not saying that unless you're born again, you can't go to heaven after you die. He was not saying that. He was saying, unless you're born again, you're not going to get it when these upside-down values of the kingdom are put in front of you. When you should forgive rather than push back. When you should give away possessions rather than accumulate them. When you should just decorate the inside rather than decorating the outside. If you're not born again, you ain't going to get it. But these are the values of my kingdom. It is so countercultural. So if you go through the Sermon on the Mount, just go through there and you're going to see that it's just, there's so many things that what the world is doing and what the kingdom is doing, they're so opposite. The kingdom of God is countercultural. So, when we invite people to follow Christ, we are inviting them into a countercultural kingdom. We are not asking people to be just opposite of whatever the world is doing. That's not what we're asking. We're asking them to be right side up with the kingdom of heaven. That's what we're asking. This is a cause worth living for, and it is worth dying for, and it makes every day terribly exciting. How can I be a part of bringing the kingdom of heaven onto earth? Living for the values of heaven while living on the earth. It's a terribly exciting way to live. Every day you have the potential to talk to someone, to do something with your bank account, to dress in a certain way. You're representing the kingdom every single day. All right. In closing tonight. By the way, I'll give you just a minute to think here. I'm just going to open it up just if you have something to share in response. Maybe you're stunned in silence. I don't know. It seemed pretty quiet here tonight. But if you have something you want to share, maybe you want to push back a little bit. You can do that too. But so I'm just going to, we're not going to have an invitation tonight, but I just, my burden is, I don't want to be us to be embarrassed about what we're doing. I want us to pass this on as vibrant Christians, not as somebody that has a shell of whatever, religiosity and nothing on the inside, not that, but a counter-cultural stranger and a pilgrim living sold out for the love of Christ, for the kingdom of God. I want to pass that on to my children. I want to the next generation to be just as many as those of you that are sitting here. And it goes on and on. That's what I want. Do not be ashamed of that. That's my heart in this message. When we get a hold of the values of the kingdom of heaven and the values of the kingdom get a hold of us, we will be non-acculturated and non-assimilated, and we will be effective in our calling. This is a worldview that is biblical, it is compelling, and it is worth defending. Remember how you felt when you first talked to a Jehovah's Witness. You were sure that they were wrong, but you were also sure that they were so entrenched in their worldview that they probably would never change. Changing a wrong worldview outside of the power of God is nearly impossible, but think of the potential if all of our children could become entrenched with the right worldview. Think of the far-reaching effects. If we can establish that our worldview is valid and develop it in the hearts of our children, we will be relevant. People are worried about being relevant. We will be relevant, and we stand a chance to be non-acculturated, non-assimilated families and churches serving joyfully and fruitfully in the kingdom of God. Let's bow our heads for prayer, then I'll just open it up for you if you have any feedback. Let's pray. Lord, this, I don't know. I said so much, probably too much. Maybe it seems like a big ball of mush. Somehow, Lord, I pray that this church and everyone that is here tonight would just take away something. Something of your kingdom. Something of being a stranger and a pilgrim. Something about the countercultural kingdom of God, something about the influence that we have allowed in our lives from the pressure of the worldly culture, and make a turn. In Jesus' name.